Ragnhild Andersen or Kristiansdatter was 82 years old when she died in the United States. Her story is well documented when in Norway, when she had given birth to a child in 1836, and thereafter she drowned it. Ragnhild was imprisoned for this crime. But the story starts here at a cottage place in Ringsaker, where she was born in 1812. This is the beautiful Roman church of Ringsaker. It was built in around 1150 and is untouched since, except for the spire. It dates from 1696. The Ringsaker church was the place where Ragnhild was baptized in March 1812, and where she was confirmed in 1826. This is the farm of Store Kindle, a farm of around 400 acres, that's much in Norway. This is the farm where Ragnhild drowned her child when she worked here as a maid. My name is Hans Petter Schönsby. I am a retired doctor. Community medicine is my specialty. But being very interested in history from my youth, I have spent most of my retirement working with local history, mainly based on documents and records from the regional archive in Hamar. Hamar is the capital of the inland of southern Norway. And my main interest was the social, cultural, and medical history from this region in the first part of the 19th century. During my search in these public records some years ago, I came across some papers about a young woman. The reading of these papers grew into a fascinating, moving, and well-documented story with many layers and probably of interest for anyone interested in the emigration between our two nations and in the brave people who sought a better fate and future than their homeland could provide. So, the good people at the regional archive in Hamar and I found it more than appropriate to share this person's fate with you. Here we go then. On November the 6th in 1836, the lensmann, or the local policeman, the sheriff, in the parish of Ringsaker in Norway, Elias Heltberg, wrote to his superior, the Fogd Hansen, in the district of Hedemarken. The Fogd was the head of the local police. Tuesday the 2nd of this month, a newborn dead child has been found in a pond close by the farm of Store Kindle. At the investigation, the maid servant Ragnhild Kristiansdatter, the daughter of Kristian, Store Kindle, confessed to be the mother of the child, which was the reason why I sent her to the district jail of Ulsrud today. Already the following day, the sorenskriver, or the district judge, ordered the county medical officer, Albert Blair, to perform a post-mortem examination of the child. This was carried out on the 8th and 11th of November. In his report, Blair confirmed that the child was dead by drowning. This child was born in concealment. And to be born in concealment, that implied a criminal offense. According to the law at that time, which was the country law of Norway, from 1687, the mother was automatically guilty and were to be punished severely. I quote, "Women of easy virtue who killed their child should lose their neck and their head put upon a stake." The following section of the law, women who gave birth in concealment received the same punishment when the child, I quote, "is born dead or in other ways dead, then she shall be regarded as if she had killed her child on purpose." It is to be noted that the burden of proof lied with the accused. So in such cases, the legal protection was not very prominent, to say it mildly, at that time. And now we must go back to the Middle Ages. The oldest Norwegian criminal law was meant to create agreement between the accused and the offended and his family. 1,000 years ago, this was the law at that time. That is the reason why homicide cases, as a rule, were settled with fines for the bereaved. Imprisonment was not of interest at that time. The Reformation in 1537 created a new basis for the criminal law, which was radically changed. What happened? This was the Reformation. It was now Lutheranism in its most literal form that left its mark on the criminal law. With other words, the new criminal law was strongly based on the Old Testament. The starting point of this law became deeds that could displease God. And that meant also that cases involving licentiousness and immorality were considered more serious than crimes of violence. For example, intercourse without being married was penalized. Men were mostly able to escape prosecution, not the woman. As a rule, it was the woman who was left with shame and punishment, and what hurt most, she became a victim of the ostracisms of the local community. They were often merciless, so it is not surprising that births in concealment were not unusual. The crime of enlightenment and the humanizing of society led to a considerably milder practice of the criminal law from the middle of the 18th century. It became usual that women who gave birth in concealment were pardoned and instead sentenced to imprisonment. In Norway, a new criminal law based on modern judicial principles took over in 1842. This meant that the death penalty from 1687 was abolished and the sentence became around 3 to 4 years imprisonment. Those of you who have read Knut Hamsun's Growth of the Soil will remember Inger, who had to serve her sentence in the prison of Trondheim. This Nobel Prize rewarded book from 1920 took probably place around 1850, 60. So this sort of criminality did not disappear when the law, new law, was introduced. One of the country's leading historians on this subject, Professor Langeland, reflected on this in 2005. a few years ago. A time limit of 24 hours constituted the original connection between birth and concealment and to bereave the child of its life. If the child did not appear before that time, it was reason to believe that the woman had given life in concealment because she wanted to take the child's life. This underlines the size of the problem in the 19th century, socially and legally, also after the introduction of modern criminal law. Today, this is a marginal problem, as it is here. We now prefer to believe that mothers who kill their newborn baby must be mentally ill. That was not the case 150 years ago, the time of Ragnhild Christian's daughter. I will now take you back to Hedemarken, where Ragnhild lived. There is no reason to believe that the parish of Ringsaker, where Ragnhild lived, and the county of Hedemarken differed from the general situation in Norway. Between 1813 and 1853, the regional archives in Hamar registered totally 40 forensic cases. In 24 of these cases, the court ordered an inquest and post-mortem examination as it suspected that homicide might be involved. The child's mother was almost without exception unmarried. She was around 20 years old and belonged to the lowest layer of the population, that of the cottars and the farmhands, those without any property. She had a minimal, if any, education, and not all of them could read. She had to leave her home early, normally after confirmation, and usually to work as a housemaid on a farm. The father of the child mostly belonged to the same social stratum. He lived in the same area, and it was not uncommon that he was married. At this time, the local society kept a close eye at its young women. The one who officially executed this function was the community parson. He was a civil servant as well, and also responsible for the population register of the parish, and all births were to be reported to him. Ragnhild was immediately suspected, as we have heard, and she soon admitted that the child found in the pond was hers. She was then arrested by the sheriff, the lensmann, who placed her in confinement in the district jail at the farm of Olsrud in the neighbor parish of Vang, some 10 to 15 kilometers away. On Thursday of the 10th of November, 1836, she was interrogated. The minutes gave a fair picture of Ragnhild and her background. I quote, "The witness Ragnhild Christiansdatter Store Kindli said she was 23 years old, born in a cottage place under the farm of Somsal by parents Christian Olsen and Anne Olsdatter, who both are alive and live in a cottage farm called Nilstuen in Ringsaker Åsmark, some 10 kilometers away in the inland of Ringsaker. Ragnhild stayed home until she was 12 years old. From that time, she has served as a maidservant in different places, that means farms, namely on Dæhlie, Somsal, Hersjø, Lene, and last on Kindli. She has never been prosecuted or punished for any offense. As to the object of the interrogation, she open-heartedly confessed this. Since 1835, she had several times intercourse with a married man, Hans Gulbrandsen. And in the beginning of this year, she felt pregnant. However, when the father of the child at this time became ill and died before the birth, she had no opportunity to communicate about the situation. I have examined the minutes of the church register, and indeed, Hans Gulbrandsen, he died on the 28th of April of typhoid fever. Ragnhild's course of life so far corresponded with what was usual for her rank in the community, as she was supposed to stay in the class she was born. Other ways out of that rigid system was practically closed, although the modernization of the country, with loosening up of the privileges and increased social mobilization, had recently begun. Ragnhild lived an unnoticed life and did not differ from the majority. She was born on the 2nd of March in 1812 and christened in Ringsaker Church on the 18th of March on the same year. In 1826, she was confirmed in the same church. Her marks for knowledge and behavior were average, the same results as for most of the other confirmants. She was described as, I quote, 60 inches high, has blue eyes, blonde eyebrows, a somewhat narrow face, and brown hair. So she did not differ in that respect either. And now, the trial. This was handled in the local court of justice, and the sentence was pronounced on the 18th of January, 1837. She was sentenced to, I quote, lose her neck and head to be put on a stake. That is, she was sentenced to death. She appealed, and the appeal to the Court of Appeal in Christiania was sent on the 28th of January. 3 months later, this court rejected the appeal, as expected. The High Court was the next address. However, the law was clear and the High Court ratified the decision taken. The next step was to send a petition of mercy to the king. And in December 1837, the king's commissioner in Hedemarken could send the following message to Fogd Hansen. I quote, "The Royal Department of Justice and Police has under the first of this month written as follows to the King's Commissioner in the county, that Ragnhild Christiansdottir of North Hedemarken Court District is graciously freed from the verdict of the High Court of 28th of September, having her life lost and her head put on a stake by being left to the grace of the king." Fogd Hansen was also ordered to send Ragnhild as soon as possible to the prison in Christiania. This departure took place on the 17th of December, and 4 days later, the prison authorities could sign for the receipt of Ragnhild in a letter to Fogd Hansen. Ragnhild was now in prison in Christiania. This prison, which also served as a correctional facility, was built in 1741 as a consequence of the reorganization of the poor relief in Norway. The institution had originally many functions. An important task was isolation of all who were unworthy poor. Unworthy poor, vagrants, beggars. Worthy poor people, the ill and the parentless, for example. The next group was women with so-called immoral conduct, such as intercourse outside marriage. Many were also imprisoned because of theft. And in addition, in this institution, there were also a few cubicles for mentally ill. Under their stay, the inmates had to work hard for a small payment. This included, of course, also Ragnhild. Such work was considered a combination of punishment and education. Ragnhild worked later as a spinner, and it is not unlikely that she learned this skill in prison. The opinion differed about this institution. One of the inspectors at the end of the 18th century meant that it gave rise to more criminals than it improved the character of the prisoner, an argument which is not unusual today as well. The prison of Christiania was a beautiful Baroque building. Its address was Storgaten 33, Storgaten Main Street 33, and was demolished in 1938. And now Ragnhild was released on the 28th of February 1842. She was 30 years old, 4 years in prison. She was equipped with a passport. And why? Yes, because passports were compulsory at that time when traveling domestic in Norway. And this was abolished in 1860. This passport was issued by the commissioner of Christiania, and she was ordered to report to the authorities in the municipality when she came home. She also had to report the removal from Christiania to the parson in Ringsaker. She was included in the parson's population register of 18th of June in 1843. It is here noted that she was 30 years old, that she was a former prisoner, and that the purpose of her removal back to Ringsaker, I quote, was in her place of birth to earn her bread. And her address and place of work was the farm of Smestad, situated in the northern part of Ringsaker, not far from the present town of Moelv and the lake Mjøsa. She had got a job. She reported removal to Ringsaker about 13 months after being released from prison. This was not unusual because many wanted to establish themselves in the community before they reported to the parson. Her past was, of course, well known, and she was a marked person. It is reasonable that she needed time, and we understand that she wanted to act and to behave correctly. Ragnhild soon found herself a man, and on the 29th of December 1842, she married, I quote, Andreas Arnesen, widower and farmhand. Andreas was 2 years younger than Ragnhild. He lived in a cottage house, a place under the farm of Ødemo, neighbor of the farm of Smestad, where Ragnhild worked at that time. Ragnhild and Andreas got a daughter, Christiane, and she was born in 1843. But then, Andreas died already 2 years later, and Ragnhild was alone again. However, Andreas had a brother, Mons Arnesen. And Mons and Ragnhild got a son, Andreas, in 1846, and he was probably named after his uncle. At last, in 1850, Mons and Ragnhild were married. In the parish register, it is stated that, I quote, marriage with deceased man's brother is permitted according to Royal Commission of 12th of October 1850. The point is that this prohibition against marriage between people related by marriage was formally abolished as late as 1993, where a new law of marriage was approved in Norway. Ragnhild was now named widow and innerst, thus without a farm worker, without any property, and the lowest step on the social ladder. In February 1851, Ragnhild's third child was born, and the boy was given the name of Bernt. Bernt was the Scandinavian version of the more continental name of Bernard. In February, as opposed to his brother Andreas, Bernt was confirmed in 1865. He had good marks and was placed as number 6 on the church floor, as the custom was at this time. This was quite a prestation from someone from such a humble origin. We like to believe that Ragnhild was very proud of Bernt. And then, from around 1850, the economy of the country went from fear to worse. Norway was overpopulated in relation to the production of the land, and the gap between poor and rich grew wider. The land was not so egalitarian as before. Beggary and social distress was one of the most important consequences. The unskilled workers were the main victims because the unemployment was most widespread in that part of the population. And never has the country had so many cutters as in this period. The country of Norway was ripe for emigration. The young and the strong ones, those who wanted to make a future elsewhere, moved either domestic to the growing cities or northwards, but especially to the United States of America. The immigration from Hedemarken was considerable already in the middle of the century, and it almost exploded after the Civil War. In 1866, there moved around 250 able-bodied persons from Ringsaker, almost 90% of them to the United States. Among them were Ragnhild Kristiansdottir and their son Bernt. As many of you know, there were three large waves of emigration from Norway to the United States. The first, from 1866 to the beginning of the 70s, then the beginning of the 80s, and the last from around 1900 to the end of the decade. There were many motives behind this mass emigration: poverty and no prospects of a brighter future, and decreasing living conditions have been mentioned above. In the United States, the Homestead Act of 1863 and the end of the Civil War 2 years later were very important pull factors. So were, of course, the upswing of the market and the prosperous times in the United States in this period. In total, around 500,000 Norwegians left their home country for the United States from 1860 to 1905. And up to 1890, they were mostly recruited from the inland counties of Hedemarken and Oppland, later from the southern and coastal provinces. The consequences of this relatively large loss of population have been debated by historians because the emigration at the end concerned, I quote, every rural district and neighborhood in the whole country. And I must mention for you our grand lady of emigration history, Professor Ingrid Semmingsen, and I quote her, this enormous and at the same time peaceful emigration of single individuals and families who had decided to break up is one of the mightiest movements known to history. Ragnhild Kristiansdatter and her family now became a part of this movement. And then the journey to the United States of America. On the 20th of April 1866, the community parson in Ringsaker noted that Ragnhild Kristiansdatter, with son Bernt, born on the 24th of February 1851, reported that they were to emigrate to America. This was surely well considered. Bernt was confirmed some months before, while Mons and the 15 years old Andreas had already left in 1861 to prepare for the arrival of the rest of the family. The departure of Ragnhild and Bernt was probably postponed because of the Civil War. In the period between 1861 and 66, Ragnhild and her son had rooms at a farm called Slotte, the castle, situated in the same neighborhood as before. She was now mentioned as a spinner, and this was probably the way she subsisted in this period. Her oldest child, the daughter Christine, married in Ringsaker in 1868 and left with her husband, farm worker Ludwig Larsen, and their small daughter Gunda for America in 1869. Ragnhild and Bernt's route is not documented. That was because obligatory passenger lists were first introduced in 1868. We must therefore assume that they followed the route which was usual for those who emigrated from the inland of Southeast Norway. They traveled with a paddle steamer on Lake Mjøsa to Eidsvoll and then trained to Christiania, their port of departure in April 1866. In this year, 10% of the emigrants traveled with steamships, the rest with sailing ships. A few years later, the steamship traffic had taken over. It was far faster. Passengers sailed from Christiania to England and from there 14 days to New York, and then trained to Chicago and the Middle West. Ragnhild and Bernt, however, probably sailed directly from Norway to Quebec. This journey was long, up to 2 to 3 months, and often strenuous and fatiguing. The hygienic circumstances were not satisfactory, and the diet not always sufficient. Communicable diseases on board were not rare. From Quebec, the journey continued on a steamship on the St. Lawrence River to the Great Lakes and into the Middle West, and the little family had reached its destination. Prepaid tickets and money for the journey were rather common at this time. They were sent from the USA to Norway, mainly by family members who had emigrated previously. We may assume that Mons, Ragnhild's husband, and who came over in 1861, had taken care of this. The family ended in Wisconsin and the part of the United States where most Norwegian emigrants settled. This region consisted then of the states of Iowa, Illinois, Wisconsin, and Minnesota, and somewhat later, the Dakotas. 90% of those who emigrated from Norway to the United States in the 1860s settled in this area. In the census for 1870, we find the family in the northwest of Wisconsin in Rush River in St. Croix County. In this census, Mons is referred to as farmer, and Ragnhild, or Rachel, as she is called here, as farmer's wife. Andreas or Andrew, Bernd or Benjamin, and Ludwig or Lodewijk as farm laborers. And they had changed their surnames to Andersson. Christiane is now Christina and is, I quote, at home. And the value of the property was estimated at $1,500 and the movables at $300. They were indeed settled. And now the end of this story of Ragnhild. She grew up in poor circumstances in the inland of Norway. The family was placed on the bottom of the social ladder. She had a criminal record and was probably stigmatized in the local society. She was a victim of customs and circumstances belonging to the past and with poor prospects for the rest of her life. She ended up as a respected farmer's wife in the United States of America. And last but not least, the family had become freeholders. Before she died, 82 years old, in 1894, she even lived to see her son, Bernd, as an attorney. Ragnhild must have been strong-willed and brave, substantial as he must have been for this indeed impressive class travel. Ragnhild's children were all married, and their descendants are spread over the United States, most of them in the Middle West. They have all reasons to be proud of their ancestors. Ragnhild's story may for some seem remote and irrelevant. However, we must not forget that it is not long ago that Ragnhild stayed imprisoned in Christiania. The great-grandfathers of the older of us were born or grew up at that time. They experienced the attitudes and views of the 19th century, but they also took part in the modernization of the country. A period of growing standard of living, better possibilities for work and education, a humanized criminal law, and not to forget the opening of the road to female emancipation and equal rights. So they witnessed the development of a more just society. Ragnhild Kristiansdottir would have liked that. Thank you very much.